Hello everyone. Now we are studying the points garbage collection, finalize method, the final keyword and packages. Now let's see these points one by one. Garbage collection. Now what is meant by the garbage collection? First you have to understand first what is the garbage meaning in the Java. In Java, the garbage means unreferenced objects. The garbage collection is a process of reclaiming the runtime unused memory automatically. In other words, it is a way to destroy the unused objects. For garbage collection in C language, free function is used, and in C++ language, delete function is used. But Java handles this deallocation automatically. Since objects are dynamically allocated by using the new operator, so you might be wondering how such objects are destroyed and their memory released for the later reallocation. So in C language, free function and C++ delete operator is used. But Java takes a very different approach. It handles this deallocation for us automatically. So the technique that accomplishes this task is called as a garbage collection. And it works like this. When no references to an object exist, that object is assumed to be no longer needed, and the memory occupied by the object can be reclaimed. So there is no explicit need to destroy the objects as like in the C++ language. The garbage collection only occurs sporadically, that is, if at all, during the execution of your program. Then see here the advantages of the garbage collection. Because of the garbage collection occurs automatically, so there is no need to make the extra efforts for the memory reallocation or to free the memory. So it makes the Java memory very efficient, because garbage collector removes the unreferenced objects from the heap memory. And as you know that it is automatically done, so we don't need to make any extra efforts. So how can we unreference the object? So there is a way you can unreference the object by nulling the reference of an object. Okay, for example, suppose there is an employee class, and we have created here the E object of that employee class, then just simply assign the null value to that object, then that reference will be unused, or that reference will be unreferenced. Okay, next, the finalize method. Sometimes an object will need to perform some action when it is destroyed. For example, suppose if an object is holding some non-Java resource such as file handle or window character font, then these resources should be freed before an object is destroyed. To handle such situation, Java provides a mechanism called finalization. The finalize method is invoked each time before the object is garbage collected. This method can be used to perform the cleanup processing. To add a finalizer to a class, simply define the finalize method. Okay. So to add a by using the finalization, you can define the specific actions that will occur when an object is just about to be reclaimed by the garbage collector. So to add a finalizer to a class, you can simply add the finalize method in your program. Then the Java runtime calls that method whenever it is about to recycle an object of that class. Inside the finalize method, you will specify those actions that must be performed before an object is destroyed. The garbage collector runs periodically and checking for the objects that are no longer referenced or no longer used by any running state, or indirectly through other referenced objects. So at that time, right before an asset is freed, the Java runtime calls the finalize method on the object. So the finalize method has a general form like this: protected void finalize, and the finalization code will be here. Here, the keyword protected is a specifier, okay, that prevents the access to the finalize by code defined outside its class. Then the next method is the GC method. It is very important method of the garbage collector. GC method, G stands for the garbage, C stands for the collector. That is garbage collector method, that is GC method. Java's garbage collector runs periodically to recycle the unused objects. But sometimes there is a need to collect the discarded objects prior to the collector's next appointed rounds. At that time, we can run the garbage collector on demand by calling the GC method. The GC method is used to invoke the garbage collector to perform the cleanup processing. The GC method is found in system and runtime classes. So this method has the general form like this: public static void GC. Then the next point we are discussing here, that is the final keyword. The final keyword in Java is used to restrict the user. That is, the Java final keyword can be used in many contexts or in many ways. Like a final can be a variable, final can be a method, final can be a class. So then let's see these types of this final variable one by one. Here first there is a final variable. When you make any variable as a final, then you cannot change the value of that final variable because it will act like a constant. Variables declared as final do not occupy any memory. So thus a final variable is essentially a final, means final variable is act like a constant. If you make any method as a final, then you cannot override it. Means that method cannot be overridden. While method overriding is one of the most Java's powerful feature, but there are the times when you don't want the override. Okay, so at that time we want to prevent the occurring. So to disallow a method from being overridden, you can specify the final as a modifier at the start of its declaration. Then that method will not be overridden. Since final methods cannot be overridden, a call to a method can be resolved at compile time. Okay, and this is called as a static binding or the early binding. Means the methods, when we declared methods as a final, that method can be resolved at the compile time, not runtime. So that's method that is called as a static binding, and that method, final methods, cannot be overridden. Next type of the final class is the final keyword is the final class. If you make any class as a final, then you cannot extend it. That is, you cannot inherit from that base class as a subclass. In other words, we can say that once a class is declared as final, we cannot inherit a subclass from that class. Our the next point is packages. Now, what is meant by the package? A Java package is a group of the similar type of the classes, interfaces, and the sub packages. And to create a package, simply include a package command as a first statement in a Java source file. The package statement defines a namespace in which classes are stored. If there is no package statement we are using, then class names are put into the default package. Then advantages of the, what are the different types, different kinds of the advantages of the packages? Java package is used to categorize the classes and the interfaces so that they can be easily maintained. Java package provides access protection, and Java package removes naming collision also. These are all the advantages of the Java package. Now, how to create a package? How we can create a package? So the general form of the package statement is like this: package pkg. So here package is the keyword and mypack is the package is the keyword we are using here, and PKG is the name of that package. For example, suppose I have created here the package named MyPack. Then package here is the keyword, and name of the my package is the MyPack. So more than one file can include the same package statement. The package statement simply specifies to which package the classes defined in a file belong. That is, a package statement indicates that to which package the classes are included or to which package the classes are belongs. Next, importing packages. Importing packages. Java includes the import statement to bring the certain classes or the entire packages into visibility. So when we once imported a class, that class can be referred to directly using only its name. So since classes within the packages must be fully qualified with their package name or the names, it could be become very tedious to type in the long dot separated package path name for every class you want to use. So for this reason, Java includes the import statement to bring the certain classes or the entire packages into visibility. This import statement is a very convenient to the programmer, and it is not technically needed to write a complete Java program. So if you are going to refer to a few dozen classes in your application, so the import statement will save a lot of typing here. So that's why the import statement can be useful for the programmers. In a Java source file, import statements occur immediately following the package statement and before any class definitions. So here the general statement of the import statement, like import, there is a keyword import, and then pkg1 dot pkg2 dot class name or star. So here pkg is the name of the top level package. Pkg2 is the name of the sub-package. Sub-package is the package inside that package. Then class name or star. The class name indicates that the name of the class that you are specifying explicitly. Or star indicates that the Java compiler should import the entire package. So finally, you specify either an explicit class name or a star, which indicates that the Java compiler should import the entire package. But when you're importing the packages, then explicitly specifying a class name is a better idea. Because when you specify explicitly a star, then compiler know that it should import the entire package. So the star form may increase the compilation time. So especially if you import the several large packages. So for this reason, it is a good idea to explicitly name the classes that you want to use rather than importing the whole packages. So there is not absolutely no effect on the runtime performance or size of your idea, but it is a good effort or good type to specify the class name only. Next, approaches to access a package. So one of the type or approach is the explicitly specifying a class name. So example, see here, import java.util.date. So here import it is the keyword, then Java it is the top level package, in that util it is the sub package, and date it is the class name that you have explicitly specified here. Then second type is the specifying a star. So import, see here in the example, import java.io.star. So import keyword, then Java is the top level package, that IO it is the sub package, and star it indicates that the you are importing the whole package. Then suppose you want to use a class name, you can use its fully qualified name, which includes its full package hierarchy. So with import statement, import java.util.star. So here, see example there, when you are using the approach that fully qualified name. So example is the class my date extends the date. Same example without import statement looks like this. Class my date extends java.util.date. So see here, if you are using only the class name, then you can without the import statement looks like the class my date extends java.util.date. So whenever you use this class, then at that time whenever you use this package, then at every time you have to write the full qualified name. And when you include the import statement, then you only specify the import java.util.star. At that time, you only specify in your example or in your program that class myDate extends date only. There is no need to specify the full qualified name. So it saves your time and it avoids the complexity of your program.